password pusher is a secure and open source way to send passwords to other people. Because as we all know, it's super risky to share passwords in clear text through email, chat, or text messages. With password pusher, you simply enter in the password you want to share, you choose your expiration options, and then you click push it. You're then given a link and a QR code that you can share with the password recipient, and you can be sure that the password isn't sitting out there in someone's email for the rest of eternity or in their SMS history, because it expires based on your settings, and once it's gone, it's gone. And your first thought might be, hey, wait a minute, why the heck would I put my password into some random website? Isn't that inherently insecure? And yeah, I mean, I guess it could be, but keep in mind that you're not sharing a username or the website that that password belongs to. You're only sharing the password. Not to mention that all of the code is open source, so you can review it yourself. And you can even add in a passphrase that has to be used to retrieve the shared password in order to make it a little bit more secure. But if you're still thinking, no way, bro, I have serious trust issues, then the good news is you can absolutely just host your own instance of Password Pusher yourself. And it's super, super easy to do. So if you want to learn how to set up your own secure password sharing website, just follow these steps and you'll be up and running in no time. Let's get started. I started Rogue Support over a year ago to help folks who needed networking advice and troubleshooting from experts. And people are loving the service. Just listen to these recent 5-star reviews. Cameron P. said, Rogue Support did a great job setting up my 5-unit rental property network. Explained everything along the way so I can comfortably maintain it. Thanks. Mercedes L. said, so happy with the support I received, I will be a repeat customer. So you too can be a happy Rogue Support customer if you're sick of getting the runaround from vendor support and you just want your network or wireless issue fixed by an expert. So check us out on the web at rogue.support and remember, you don't pay anything until your issue is resolved. Give it a shot today, you won't be disappointed. Self-hosting Password Pusher is incredibly easy to do, and it takes less than 15 minutes from start to finish. I'm going to show you how to do it in this video, but I've also created full written instructions in a blog post on crosstalksolutions.com if that's easier for you to follow along with. Plus, you can copy and paste all of the commands. Now, you're going to need two things to get started. You need a bare metal or cloud-hosted server running Docker, as well as a fully qualified domain name that you can use for your password pusher website. I'm going to be using Vulture in this example. They are a great cloud hosting provider, and I have a link down in the description below if you want to check them out. Now, you could also use DigitalOcean or any other provider that can get you a server running Docker. And while you can use your own bare metal server for this project, you'll have the added step of port forwarding through your firewall, which I'm not going to cover in this tutorial, but it's actually pretty straightforward to do that. For the FQDN, I'm going to be using pwpush.crosstalknetworking.com. So replace that with your own fully qualified domain name wherever I use it. You'll also need access to your domain hosting service in order to add a DNSA record for your domain. I have my domain, you know, crosstalknetworking.com, hosted with Cloudflare. So I'm going to be showing you how to add the A record with Cloudflare, but it should be very similar no matter who your DNS provider is. Okay, let's get started by logging into Vulture. Okay, so I'm going to be following along with my own blog post instructions. You can find those at crosstalksolutions.com, but we're going to start over at Vulture, and you want to say deploy up in the upper right hand corner and then deploy new server. Now, I want to get the absolute cheapest option possible, so I'm going to do cloud compute shared CPU. And then you want to pick your location. In my case, I'm going to use Silicon Valley, we'll say. Then where it says choose image, we want to go to Marketplace Apps, and they already have a one-click install for Docker. So we're just going to search for Docker, and then we're going to choose Docker and scroll down a little bit more. And now if you go over to regular cloud compute, this is where you can find the 25 gigabyte SSD, one virtual CPU, 1 gig of RAM. It's going to be $5 per month, or you can add an extra dollar to get the AMD high performance, same specs, but AMD another dollar a month. Now, if you scroll down further under additional features, we can disable auto backups and say, yes, I understand the risks, but we're going to disable our backups anyways. The reason we're disabling backups is that there's nothing saved on this server, right? Password push by design doesn't save any of those passwords or any of that information. So if the server crashed completely, the only thing that you would lose are passwords that you've pushed that haven't hit their expiration yet. But we don't need to take backups because there's really nothing to restore. If we ever need to restore the server, we can just fire up a brand new instance. So we're going to be logging in with an SSH key. I already have one pre-configured in Vulture, so I'm going to choose that pre-configured SSH key. But if you need to add an SSH key, you can just hit the plus sign here and add your own SSH key. And then again, for the FQDN, I'm using pwpush.crosstalknetworking.com. And that fills out the server host name as well as the server label. And we're gonna say deploy now. Deploying the server just takes a minute or so, and once it's deployed, you're gonna get an IP address. So we can copy that IP address, and we can load it into PuTTY or a similar SSH application. So I'm gonna paste that IP address into PuTTY. Since we're using an SSH key to connect, I then also need to go to connection, SSH, off, and then credentials, and I need to load the PuTTY private key file. And then going back to session, I can save this as password pusher, hit save to save those settings, and click open. And then we can say accept, and we wanna log in as root. Okay, so there we go. We have logged in as root, and now the first thing that I'm gonna do is make sure that this server is fully up to date, and I'm gonna do that by saying apt update and apt upgrade dash y. Okay, so this is gonna check for all the latest versions of all of the installed packages, and then it's going to install those with the dash y flag, meaning just force install them, don't prompt me every time a new one needs to be installed. Now, if you get something like this, pending kernel upgrade, just say okay. And then something like this, just say okay, you know, just get through all of those different settings. It may tell you that you should reboot the instance, and if that's the case, you can just type reboot, enter, and then in about a minute, it'll be back up and running. While you're running those upgrades, and before we actually dig into the password pusher installation, we need to go set up our DNS A record. So if we go back to Vulture, remember we have this IP address right here, make sure that's copied to your clipboard. And then here in Cloudflare, this is where I want to add a new A record. So what I would do here is select a record. You want to find wherever your DNS settings are, add a new host or add a new record, select type a record, and then put in the name. In my case, it's pwpush. Typically, it's going to append the domain name automatically, as you see it did right here, pwpush.crosstalknetworking.com. And then we want to paste in the IP address given to us by Vulture, and basically in this case, we don't need proxy status for Cloudflare. You probably don't have that same setting, but then we're gonna say save, and that DNS A record is created. Now, the reason we wanna do this earlier in the process is because sometimes DNS takes a little while to propagate, and so we just wanna, you know, give it some time to make sure that it's out there in the world before we actually need to use it by opening up our password push website. So again, I have instructions here on the blog post. Let's go ahead and follow the next things that we need to do, which are basically pull down the configuration file for password push, which is actually a Docker compose file, right? So then we run the Docker compose file, and that pulls all of the various Docker containers that we're gonna need. In this case, it's actually just two Docker containers. So we're gonna say make dir pwpush. Then we're gonna change directory into pwpush, so cd pwpush. And then we wanna grab these two files with wget. So I've got this one here. Control C to copy, shift insert to paste. Okay, so we got that first file. And then we need our caddy file. This is our configuration for the Let's Encrypt cert. Copy to clipboard, shift insert, and enter. And there we go. So now we have all of the files that we need downloaded. All right, so the next thing we need to do is tell Let's Encrypt our information, right? So we're gonna edit that caddy file, so nano caddy file. And there's two settings here. So we have our email, In this case, I'm just going to use info@crosstalksolutions.com. And then a little bit further down, we have our domains. We want to replace this with our fully qualified domain name. In my case, it's crosstalknetworking.com. Control X, Y, and save that file. All right, so the next thing we do is fire up our Docker container. We do it with this command, docker. Oop, let me shrink this down so we can see everything on one screen here. All right, so it's this command right here. I will fix that. It's not in code on the blog post. I'll fix that by the time this goes live. So we do docker compose dash F. So we're saying use this file for your configuration, which is going to be the docker compose pwpush.yaml file. And we're going to say up and dash D. So what that's saying is we're going to run this in the background and we want to go ahead and start these containers. Now, see what it's doing here is it's pulling down all of the information that it needs for both of these containers, which are the password push container as well as the Let's Encrypt certificate container. And it looks like it finished up already. Right now, you could be done, okay? We're going to do a little bit more to secure things down a little bit, but if you bring up your fully qualified domain name in a browser, theoretically, assuming that everything was done correctly, you should have your password push server up and running. Let's try that now. Boom, there we go, password pusher. So this is how you use it, right? We're gonna type in a password that we're gonna send to somebody. We choose our expiration options. In this case, we'll make it expire after 4 days or after 3 views. We can use a passphrase to lock it down even further if we want, but then we just say push it. And now we have a link that we can send to someone that they can retrieve that information or a QR code that they can scan with their phone. So we're gonna say copy that link. Let's open that up in a new tab. And they can copy it to their clipboard right here, or they can click on the password itself and it will display in clear text. How cool is that? Okay, so moving on, as I said, there are a couple more steps to make sure this is just a little bit better. There's two things we're gonna do. Number one, we're gonna set up the UFW firewall on our Vulture cloud hosted server, basically saying, hey, we're locking down SSH to just our IP address, and we are also closing off every other port to the rest of the world except for HTTPS port 443. The second thing we're gonna do is make sure that if the server's rebooted for any reason, this docker compose YAML file is run again and those two Docker containers fire back up, right? Because if we reboot the server, we don't wanna have to log back into the server to, you know, run that docker compose command again. We want it to happen automatically. So let's go ahead and do those two things next. So starting with our firewall, let's see what we have now. UFW status. So the firewall is not running by default, but what we have for rules by default are port 22, which is SSH, allowed from anywhere. Okay, so if I turned on the firewall right now, it's gonna lock out all other ports except for port 22, and it's gonna allow port 22 from anywhere in the world. So we wanna lock that down to just our WAN IP address. So to get your own WAN IP address, you can go to whatismyip.com, and actually I think they further abbreviated it now to wimi.com. And we're gonna say UFW allow from, and then your WAN IP. Now I'm using a /29 because I have a block of 5 IPs, but typically if you just wanna lock it down to a single WAN IP, you're gonna use a /32 in CIDR format to any port 22, and we're gonna say enter. Now if I do UFW status again, we can see I have port 22 allowing from still anywhere. We're gonna delete those rules in a second, but now also allowing from my WAN IP address. Okay, so we also wanna say UFW allow HTTPS, and that's all we have to say for that rule because we want HTTPS available from anywhere, but you could also lock this rule down as well. If you only wanted password pusher available, for example, from your own WAN IP address, maybe like the IP address of your company or organization. So now we can say UFW status numbered, And what this does is it shows us all of our rules again, but when we add numbered onto the UFW status, it gives us the number on the left-hand column. And the reason we do that is just makes things easier when we're gonna be deleting some rules. So in this case, I wanna delete the first rule, which allows TCP on IPv4 from anywhere, and I wanna delete the fourth rule, which allows TCP port 22 IPv6 from anywhere. So we're gonna say UFW delete 4, yes, and UFW delete 1, yes. All right, so now if I do UFW status, we only have our three rules. We have port 22 from my WAN IP address and nowhere else, and we have port 443 for both IPv4 and IPv6 allowed from anywhere. So I'm happy with those rules. Let's go ahead and turn them on by saying UFW enable. And yes. Okay, so that's it for firewall rules. The next thing we're gonna do is make sure that when the server reboots, those Docker containers also restart automatically. And to do that, we need to edit the Docker compose pw push YAML file. So let's do that now. Nano Docker tab, that's gonna autocomplete, enter. And if we scroll down here, oh, first of all, we can actually uncomment this top line because that version command is deprecated, so it'll give you a warning. It doesn't hurt if you don't disable it, but I like to. Scroll all the way down to our pw push here. We're gonna hit enter, we're gonna add a new line here, and then right in between image and ports, we wanna add this line, restart colon space always, and make sure that your syntax here is perfect, because YAML files, if you don't have perfect syntax, it's gonna cause an error. So we're gonna say restart colon space always. Okay, and just double check that everything's lined up properly, that it's spelled correctly, all of that sort of stuff. Let's scroll down a little bit further. We also need to do the same thing for the Let's Encrypt container. Restart colon space always. All right, so Control X, yes, enter. And now we can say docker compose dash F docker blah, blah, blah. So autocomplete with tab up dash D, enter. And it reconfigures those two containers. Now let's go ahead and do a reboot. And what we're gonna see here is I've rebooted. So if I go to my pw push server right now and reload it. So right now it's down, right? It's thinking. It doesn't have any way to get to this pwpush.crosstalknetworking.com because the server is currently rebooting. But in just a moment, it should come back up. And there we go. Okay, so less than a minute later, server reboots, services are back up, Docker containers are fired back up, and we can now get back into our password pusher server. What a cool and easy project. So thanks goes, of course, to the creators and developers of Password Pusher for giving us an awesome free open source utility. I've got a link to the blog post down in the description below, and in that blog post, I have links to the Password Pusher project as well. So here at Crosstalk Solutions, we are in the habit of using Password Pusher to send passwords to customers and receive passwords from customers securely using this utility. And it really helps show our customers that we value security when we're working on their networks and their phone systems. So definitely give this project a try. Okay, that's it for this video, but if you'd like to keep this party started, I have hand-selected a couple of videos on the right here for you to watch next. The top video is another awesome open source project, the WLAN Pi project, which is a multi-tool for wireless networking. And the bottom video is my recent complete overview of the new Starlink mini satellite dish.